I'm from a rainy place. I'm used to rain, but even so, I was surprised when I first saw rain in this data. Because Antarctica is meant to be cold, right? The authors of this new paper found that it's raining over two of Antarctica's most important glaciers. And in this video, I'm going to show you why, or more importantly, how that can be true. Oh, and surprise, I wrote this paper. It's open access, so if you're so inclined, you can read it here, and I'll also drop the link in the description. We're back in West Antarctica, focusing once again on two of Antarctica's most infamous glaciers. Thwaites and Pine Island are the gruesome twosome of ice loss, and together account for an unreasonable fraction of global sea level rise. I've done a bunch of videos about West Antarctica and Thwaites because these glaciers are spewing ice into the ocean at an alarming rate. But although we focus mostly on the ice that these glaciers are losing, we rarely think about the ice that they are gaining. Because there's only one way that glaciers, ice sheets, and ice shelves can grow, and that is from precipitation. And you get a ton of snow in this region, or to be exact, a ton of snow per meter squared per year. And that makes precipitation important because it's the only way that these losses can be offset and means it really controls the rate of those losses. But precipitation in Antarctica doesn't fall equally throughout the year. In fact, most of the year's precipitation in this region falls in just 30 days per year, which means most of it comes from short-lived extreme events featuring storms and mega dumps of snow. And lots of those extremes are associated with atmospheric rivers. If you've already seen this video, you'll know that atmospheric rivers are long, thin features in the atmosphere that transport loads of heat and moisture from one place to another. They're literally like rivers in the sky that suck up moisture from the tropics and take it right down south to Antarctica, where it smashes into the steep slopes of the ice sheet and drops all of its moisture as precipitation. One thing that came out from this paper is the importance of the steep terrain of West Antarctica, because the mountains impact the airflow a lot, driving heating over the ice shelves in exactly the same way that we see over the Antarctic Peninsula. As the atmospheric river forces its way over the terrain, moisture condenses into clouds and then falls as precipitation, meaning we see lots of snow and rain on these slopes. But then as the air descends on the other side, the air is heated by compression, resulting in the development of a pool of warm air near the surface of the ice shelves. Especially over Pine Island's ice shelf, temperatures in that warm pool rise during summer cases to 8 degrees above zero in some cases. That's basically the same kind of winter temperatures that we get in London. Over the Thwaites ice shelf, atmospheric rivers dump a load of snow. We're talking 25 meters or more. And the mountains have another effect because we also see rain falling even when temperatures are below the freezing point of 0 degrees. You might think that makes zero sense because water should freeze at 0 degrees. But there are conditions when water can exist as a liquid at sub-zero temperatures, when it's known as supercooled liquid. If the water is pure, which it is in the Antarctic atmosphere, then it can stay liquid down to really low temperatures. That's because contaminants like dust or dirt particles trigger the formation of ice crystals, but those particles are few and far between in the clean atmosphere of the Antarctic. In our study, we see drizzle falling at temperatures around minus 10, but this paper showed supercooled drizzle falling in another part of West Antarctica at minus 25. The same processes that produce drizzle in warmer climates are behind this, it's just that they're happening at much colder temperatures. And the mountains also enhance precipitation via phenomenon called the cedar feeder effect, where snow and ice falling from a top layer of cloud triggers the formation of more snow in a lower cloud layer. We care about rain in Antarctica not only because it's a really useful climate indicator, but also because rain falling on snow can change the properties of the snow. And if it happens enough, it can have lasting impacts. For instance, when rain falls on fresh snow, it darkens the surface, which changes the reflectivity of the snow and can enhance melting. Darker surfaces absorb more heat, just think how it feels to wear a black t-shirt versus a white one in summer. So the darker the snow surface, the more melting occurs. And rain is a liquid, so it doesn't just stay at the surface. It can trickle down into the snowpack and refreeze into solid ice layers, which changes the way that the ice flows or reduces the resilience of ice shelves to fracture. And if it starts falling in large enough quantities, it could also play a role in lubricating glaciers, just like it does in Greenland. In fact, speaking of Greenland, there are actually a lot lot of parallels with what Jason Box and I spoke about in this video up here. What I think is pretty cool about this study, and yes, I know I'm biased, is that it shows the impact of atmospheric rivers and extreme precipitation events like this may actually have been underestimated. We used really state-of-the-art weather forecasting models here, which are much better than the broader brush data sets that are typically used, and they show much higher snow and rain totals. Having said that though, none of them get as much snow as we actually see in the observations, so it's possible that these extremes are actually way more extreme than anyone could have thought. And as the climate warms, we'll be seeing more and more of these extreme precipitation events, including much more rain. So it's pretty crucial that we start getting a handle on it now, or an umbrella. Thanks for watching. If you're a nerd and you want to check out the paper, it's over here and the link in the description. And I've also written a carbon brief post about it, which is a little bit more intelligible. Shout out to my co-authors and Polarez for funding the work. And while we're on shout outs, huge thanks to my Patreon subscribers who make these videos possible. Please consider joining them if you value the work that I do on YouTube. Now, if you want to learn more about atmospheric rivers from the Antarctic Atmospheric River Guy, then check out this video over here. Or if you'd rather learn the depressing facts about the fate of glaciers in West Antarctica, check out this one over here. Till next time!